Hello everyone, in this lecture we will talk about tubulointerstitial diseases of kidney. Starting with introduction of tubulointerstitial diseases, these are a group of diseases which are characterized by predominant involvement of tubules and interstitium. So the primary site of involvement will be tubules and interstitium, and these type of diseases, these can be both primary and secondary. Here we'll be talking about mainly the primary tubulointerstitial diseases. Coming on to general features, like most of the other illnesses, tubulointerstitial nephritis can also be divided into acute and chronic type. Acute tubulointerstitial nephritis, it will have a rapid clinical onset, and histologically there will be features of any acute inflammation, like there will be interstitial edema, there will be leukocyte infiltration predominantly of neutrophils, and there will be death of tubular epithelial cells, or there will be tubular necrosis. Similarly, on chronic tubulointerstitial nephritis, the course will be protracted or insidious type, and there will be features of chronic inflammation in the form of infiltration by mononuclear leukocytes in the form of lymphocytes, macrophages, plasma cells. Also, there will be ongoing interstitial fibrosis and widespread tubular atrophy. So these are the two differentiating features. If we have any kind of acute tubulointerstitial injury, then features like interstitial edema, there will be leukocyte infiltration predominantly of neutrophil type, and focal tubular cell death will be there. Similarly, if there is a chronic injury of tubules and interstitium, then features will be of chronic inflammation like infiltration by mononuclear leukocytes, fibrosis, and tubular atrophy. Coming on to clinical features, as we had discussed in our introductory lectures on kidney, that the glomerular diseases and tubular diseases, they have slightly different clinical presentations. So as the two features of tubules, which are the ability to concentrate urine and ion exchange, so they will be affected and there will be symptoms related to these. So basically there will be impaired ability to concentrate urine, which will present in the form of polyuria, nocturia. Also, there will be salt wasting, metabolic acidosis, and isolated defects in tubular reabsorption or secretion. Coming on to classification of tubulointerstitial nephritis. So tubules, they can be affected by in different conditions, like these can be affected due to infections, toxins, metabolic diseases, vascular diseases, physical factors, neoplasms, immunologic reactions, and other miscellaneous diseases. So talking about infections, we can have acute bacterial pyelonephritis or chronic pyelonephritis. Then there are various types of toxins that can affect the tubules, like analgesics, heavy metals. Similarly, there can be metabolic diseases which can affect the tubules because of urate, calcium, phosphate, potassium, and oxalate induced nephropathies. Then there can be vascular diseases of kidney. These we have already discussed under our section of hypertension, but still we will be touching them briefly. Then miscellaneous diseases like Bulkan nephropathy and nephronophthisis or medullary cystic disease complex. This we had already discussed in our section of cystic diseases of kidney. Then there can be tubulointerstitial injury because of physical factors, like because of chronic urinary tract obstruction, certain neoplasms like multiple myeloma, and immunologic reactions, for example, in various connective tissue disorders and transplant rejection. So the ones that I have highlighted with yellow color, we'll be talking about them in detail. Just these two diseases which I have highlighted in green, the analgesics and metabolic diseases, although I will not be discussing them, but still these are important causes of tubulointerstitial nephritis. As you can see, analgesics, these are one of the most commonly prescribed drugs, so this is an important cause to be remembered while talking about tubulointerstitial nephritis. Similarly, these metabolic diseases, they are also fairly common and they also need to be borne in mind. So we will start with infections. Starting with pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis is inflammation of renal parenchyma and pelvic ileal system. This is a part of the spectrum of urinary tract infection or simply UTI. This is broadly divided into acute pyelonephritis and chronic pyelonephritis. Coming on to etiopathogenesis, more than 85% of the cases of UTI, these are caused by gram-negative organisms of the intestinal tract. The common implicated organisms, these are E. coli, Proteus, Klebsiella, Enterobacter, Streptococcus fecalis, with E. coli being the most common one. In addition to these organisms, in certain type of patients like immunocompromised patients, here different organisms, especially polyomavirus and adenovirus, they can also cause UTI. In most patients with UTI, the infecting organisms, these are derived from patient's own fecal flora, and that is why the term endogenous infection is used, because the organisms that are occurring, they are not from outside the body, these are because of patient's own fecal flora. Now, two routes of infection are there. How these organisms gain entry into the urinary tract, these can be through the bloodstream, which is called as hematogenous infection, or these can be because of from the lower urinary tract, where it is called as ascending infection. So hematogenous spread, it is less common, and it is observed in mainly debilitated or immunocompromised patients, and it results from septicemia or infective endocarditis. Ascending infections, these are the most common route of infection. So how this ascending infection occurs in certain patients, because the urine is sterile and also there are certain protective secretions like prostatic secretions in the case of males. So a certain kind of steps they need to occur before these organisms, they can gain entry into the urinary tract infection and actually cause infection over there, because there is constant flushing by the urine. And because of that, and in addition to certain protective secretions like prostatic secretions, these organisms, these are unable to get hold into the urinary tract, because even if they get entry into the urinary tract, they will get flushed by the voiding of urine. So there are certain steps that need to occur. So what are these steps? We will discuss about these. So let's talk about these different steps that need to occur for development of UTI. First would be colonization of the distal part of the urinary tract, that is distal urethra and introitus in the case of females, by various organisms. So this involves the adhesion of the adhesive molecules on the surface of bacteria with the receptors on the surface of uroepithelial cells. So because of or with the help of these adhesins, these organisms, they latch on to the uroepithelial cells, and this is how they complete the first step, which is colonization of distal most part of the urinary tract. Then they need to ascend higher up into the urinary tract to cause symptoms there. So second step would be colonization of urinary bladder. In the case of females, the predisposing factors, these are short length of urethra, lack of protective fluids like prostatic secretions, and trauma during sexual intercourse. So all these predispose the females towards development of UTI. As you will see in your clinical practice, that a large number of patients with UTI tend to be females, and this is because of all these predisposing factors that we have just discussed. It's not that the males, they are spared of UTI. There is a certain age group or a certain subset of males which are also predisposed to development of UTI. These are the patients which required frequent catheterizations and instrumentations, and like in the case of various kinds of obstruction to urine outflow, for example, in patients with BPH. Then urinary tract obstruction and stasis of urine, they also contribute towards development of UTI. Even if these organisms, they get entry into the urinary bladder, they need to multiply there. But what happens is that because of constant flushing and voiding of urine, these organisms, these are cleared out of the urinary tract. So there has to be some degree of obstruction and stasis of urine for these organisms to multiply. So all the conditions which predispose towards urinary tract infection or they cause stasis of urine, they will contribute toward development of UTI. These can be bladder dysfunction, like in the case of diabetics and in patients with spinal cord injury. Then outflow obstruction, like in benign prostatic hyperplasia, various tumors of urinary tract, and calculi of urinary tract. So all these conditions, they lead to incomplete voiding of urine, which leads to stasis and increased residual volume in urinary bladder. So because of stasis and increased urinary residual volume, the bacteria which are introduced into the urinary bladder, these are not now flushed out completely, and this is how they get a chance to multiply in the urinary bladder. Now there are two other mechanisms. One is vesicoureteral reflux and the second one is intrarenal reflux. These are important, how these bacteria, they gain entry higher up in the urinary tract, which is above the urinary bladder. So what is this vesicoureteral reflux? Normal ureteral insertion in the urinary bladder, it is a competent one-way valve, meaning whenever the intravesical pressure, it increases, so this valve, it automatically completely shuts down so that there is no reflux into the ureters. But if there is an incompetent valve, which happens in the case of congenital shortening of intravesical part of the ureter, or there is complete absence of intravesical part of the ureter, so because of that, there is reflux of urine in the ureters at the time of increased intravesicular pressure, which would be at the time of voiding. So this would lead to introduction of infected urine higher up in the urinary tract, and that will lead to infection in the urinary tract above the urinary bladder. And this is one of the most important causes of UTI in children. Then second mechanism of reflux occurs in the kidney, which is called as intrarenal reflux. As you would recall that the papillae at the poles of kidney, they normally have flattened or concave tips, as compared to the mid zones where the papillae, they have convex tips. So because of these flattened or concave tips, there are open ducts at the tips of papillae in these particular area, which are upper and lower poles. And these allow for this infected urine to enter into the renal pelvis and parenchyma and cause infection there. So because of the presence of these flattened or concave tips at the poles, so these the areas of reflux, they will be much more at the poles as compared to mid zones. And this kind of intrarenal reflux, this can be demonstrated by voiding cystourethrogram. So because, as you have seen, that intrarenal reflux and vesicoureteral reflux, these are causing because of backflow of urine into higher up into the urethra, into the ureter and kidney. So because of that, if they are not there, the infection will predominantly be limited to the bladder and urethra only. It's only because of intrarenal reflux or vesicoureteral reflux that this infection, it ascends higher up into the urinary tract. So all these mechanisms, the colonization of distal urethra and introitus, then colonization of urinary bladder, then urinary tract obstruction and stasis of urine, which are very important contributing factors, along with vesicoureteral and intrarenal reflux, all these contribute towards infection of different part of urinary tract. So this diagram again depicts these various mechanisms of UTI. We have ascending infections where there is colonization of distal part of urethra and introitus. Then they gain entry into the urinary bladder, where there can be also associated stasis or obstruction. Along with that, there would be vesicoureteral reflux and intrarenal reflux. All these contribute towards ascending infection in UTI. Similarly, the second less important type would be hematogenous infection. Next is morphology of acute pyelonephritis. As we had discussed earlier, that acute pyelonephritis is acute suppurative inflammation of the kidney, which is caused by bacteria in most of the cases, and in some cases by viruses. And these bacteria and viruses reach the kidney by usually the ascending route of infection, and at times by hematogenous route of spread. So starting with the gross appearance of kidneys in acute pyelonephritis, the kidneys, they will be enlarged, and they will be discrete focal abscesses, which will involve one or both the kidneys. Distribution is usually haphazard. However, in reflux-associated pyelonephritis, damage would be more commonly seen in upper and lower poles because of peculiar morphology of the calluses in these particular areas. Then, in the healed phase, the areas of healed pyelonephritis will appear as depressed U-shaped scars on the surface with deformed calluses and pelvis underneath. So, on the right, we have this cross picture of acute pyelonephritis, where you can see that the kidneys, they are enlarged, and whole of the renal surface, it is studded with variable sized yellowish abscesses. Then, light microscopic appearance of acute pyelonephritis. As this is an acute inflammation, so the predominant cell population would be neutrophils. So in early stages, neutrophils, they will be limited only to the interstitium. Later on, tubules will also become involved, and neutrophils will start accumulating within the lumina of tubules. This is followed by destruction and sloughing of tubular epithelial cells. Characteristically, glomeruli, they are spared by acute pyelonephritis. However, later on, as large areas of severe necrosis, they are there. So ultimately, glomeruli will also be destroyed. One exception to this is fungal pyelonephritis, where glomeruli are also affected early in the course of disease. Then, if this acute phase heals by proper antibiotic therapy, then these neutrophils, just like inflammation elsewhere, it will be replaced by chronic inflammatory cells like macrophages, plasma cells, and lymphocytes. And the destroyed renal parenchyma will be replaced by tubular atrophy and interstitial fibrosis. So these areas with tubular atrophy and interstitial fibrosis, these are permanent scars or leftover marks of an area of healed acute pyelonephritis. So on the right, we have this light microscopic picture of acute pyelonephritis, where asterisk shows the neutrophils in the interstitium, and by the arrow we have these collection of neutrophils in the lumen of a tubule. Then there are certain complications of acute pyelonephritis which are encountered in special circumstances. These are papillary necrosis, pyonephrosis, and perinephric abscesses. So these are not seen in all patients with acute pyelonephritis, but seen in only a subset of patients. So starting with papillary necrosis, this is mainly seen in patients with diabetes and those with urinary tract obstruction, and it usually tends to be bilateral. Crossly, the tips or the distal two-thirds of the pyramids, they have these areas of depressed gray-white to yellow necrosis. This gross appearance is depicted in this picture on the right, and it is marked by these broad black colored arrows which show the areas of papillary necrosis. Then microscopically, these areas show characteristic coagulative necrosis with preservation of outlines of tubules, and leukocyte reaction, it will be limited only to the interface between the normal and affected renal tissue. So this is one complication of acute pyelonephritis, which is papillary necrosis and seen in mainly diabetics. Then another one is pyonephrosis. Pyonephrosis occurs in total or near total obstruction, which is there high in urinary tract. So whatever pus is forming or inflammatory exudate is forming in the kidney, it is unable to drain and it starts collecting in the kidney. And ultimately, the whole of the kidney is converted into a sack of pus. So suppurative exudate, because of obstruction high up in the urinary tract, it fills the renal pelvis, calluses, and ureter with pus, and ultimately kidney is also converted into a multilocular sack which is filled with pus, called as pyonephrosis or renal carbuncle. Then third is perinephric abscess. This is because of extension of suppurative inflammation through the renal capsule, and it involves the perinephric tissue. If the renal inflammation or this abscess it continues and ruptures into the perinephric tissue, then it results in a perinephric abscess. So these are the three complications of acute pyelonephritis: papillary necrosis, pyonephrosis, and perinephric abscess. Coming on to clinical features, there are various clinical scenarios which predispose the patients towards development of pyelonephritis. One is urinary tract obstruction, and other is instrumentation of lower urinary tract. So both these we had discussed in etiopathogenesis of pyelonephritis. So it makes sense that the patients, if they have obstruction anywhere in urinary tract, or if there is a requirement of instrumentation of lower urinary tract, so again it predisposes to introduction of these organisms higher up in the urinary tract and ultimately leading to pyelonephritis in a subset of patients. Then another scenario would be pregnancy. 4 to 6% of antenatal females, they develop asymptomatic bacteriuria at some point during the pregnancy, and out of these, 20 to 40% will ultimately develop UTI if they are not treated. Then gender and age considerations. After the first year of life, where these congenital anomalies in males, they become evident, and up to around 40 years of age, females are more prone to develop some form of UTI as compared to male. As we had discussed, the various predisposing factors in females like short length of urethra and absence of protective secretions of prostate. However, with age, the incidence in males, it increases as they develop BPH, and this requires frequent instrumentations and catheterizations, which again introduces organisms into the upper urinary tract, and this along with already present urinary tract obstruction all contribute towards development of pyelonephritis. Then diabetes mellitus, as these patients have increased susceptibility to infections, and also some of them will have bladder dysfunction, which will lead to stasis and increased residual volume of urine in the urinary bladder. And to relieve this, there is also frequent instrumentations in these patients. So all these will contribute towards higher chances of developing pyelonephritis in this particular subset of patients. Then immunosuppression and immunodeficiency. So coming on to presenting complaints. Complaints can be constitutional, or these are limited to the urinary tract. So constitutional complaints will be in the form of fever and malaise. Urinary complaints would be pain during urination, which is dysuria, then frequency to pass urine, and urgency. Various lab investigations that can be done to evaluate a case with UTI. One would be urine microscopy. Here we can see pus cells, RBCs, and we can also see WBC casts and RBC casts. Then on urine culture, we can identify one type or multiple types of gram-negative organisms. And then radiological examination can also be done to evaluate for any kind of urinary tract obstruction. Our treatment would be antibiotics, and usually these patients, if they have no other complicating condition, then these patients have excellent response. In presence of obstruction, diabetes mellitus, or immunodeficiency, these patients will tend to develop repeated episodes, and septicemia may develop, and these patients can also have chronic pyelonephritis. Starting with next entity, which is chronic pyelonephritis and reflux nephropathy. This is a disorder with chronic tubulointerstitial inflammation and renal scarring, which is associated with pathologic involvement of calluses and pelvis. What is important about this entity is that calluses, they tend to be spared in all other conditions except chronic pyelonephritis and analgesic nephropathy. This is one of the important causes of end-stage kidney, and it also continues to be an important cause of renal destruction in children with severe lower urinary tract abnormalities. Now, this chronic pyelonephritis can be divided into two forms. One is due to reflux nephropathy, and the other one is because of obstruction, which is also called as chronic obstructive pyelonephritis. Starting with reflux nephropathy, this is the most common form of chronic pyelonephritic scarring. As the name suggests, this is reflux nephropathy, so it is associated with some kind of reflux, which can be vesicoureteral reflux or intrarenal reflux. Both of these can cause renal scarring. Reflux, it can be bilateral or unilateral, and it occurs due to congenital absence or shortening of intravesical part of ureter, as we had discussed earlier also. Congenital absence or shortening of intravesical part of ureter leads to vesicoureteral reflux. Similarly, we have intrarenal reflux, which tends to occur at the poles of kidney. Then we have chronic obstructive pyelonephritis. Here, the pyelonephritis is because of some kind of obstruction in the urinary tract. So, recurrent bouts of infections, they superimpose on obstruction, and it leads to recurrent renal inflammation and scarring, which leads to loss of renal parenchyma, and ultimately leads to sufficient loss of renal tissue, resulting in end-stage kidney. Again, this chronic obstructive pyelonephritis can be unilateral. For example, if it is due to calculi or tumors or strictures, or it can be bilateral if there is posterior urethral valve. So these are the two different types of chronic pyelonephritis. One can be because of reflux, which can be further because of vesicoureteral reflux or intrarenal reflux, or it can be obstructive pyelonephritis, where pyelonephritis is occurring because of some kind of obstruction in urinary tract. This diagram shows chronic pyelonephritis by reflux as well as by obstruction. So on the left, we have pyelonephritis because of vesicoureteral reflux. Here, as you know, that the tips of the papillae on the poles of the kidney, they have flattened or concave appearance. So because of that, there is more chances of intrarenal reflux in these two areas. So when chronic pyelonephritis is because of this, so there will be dilatation of the pelvis, as well as the main sites of destruction, these will be on the at the poles of the kidney. Whereas if the chronic pyelonephritis, it is because of obstructive uropathy, which is usually because of obstruction higher up in the urinary tract. So first there will be dilated pelvis, and later on all the calluses, they will be more or less involved, and this will lead to scarring of renal tissue, leading to these U-shaped scars and dilatation of calluses and loss of renal parenchyma. So these are the two comparative mechanisms of pyelonephritis. If it is because of reflux, then the main areas of damage will be at the poles, whereas in obstructive uropathy, almost all areas of kidney, they will be involved. This is again diagrammatic representation of a case with chronic pyelonephritis, which is associated with vesicoureteral reflux. As we had discussed earlier also in the previous slide, that in vesicoureteral reflux, the main areas of destruction of renal parenchyma is at the poles, and this is because of the blunted calluses, which are normally also present in at the poles as compared to the mid zones of the kidney. So because of that, these are already prone to reflux, and that is why there is more loss of renal tissue and scarring at the poles of kidney in cases associated with vesicoureteral reflux. So these were two mechanisms of development of chronic pyelonephritis. One was reflux associated, and other one was obstruction associated. So morphology of chronic pyelonephritis, starting with gross appearance. The kidneys, these are irregularly contracted. That is, the renal surface, it will be uneven, and it will be smaller in size as well as weight. If bilateral involvement is there, then there will be asymmetrical involvement. This needs to be differentiated from chronic glomerulonephritis, where both kidneys, they are symmetrically involved and their surface is regularly contracted. So irregularly एंड एसिमेट्रिकली कॉन्ट्रैक्टेड किडनी अकर्स इन क्रॉनिक पाइलोनेफ्राइटिस, वेयर एज सिमेट्रिकली एंड रेगुलरली कॉन्ट्रैक्टेड किडनी दिस अकर्स इन क्रॉनिक ग्लोमेरुलोनेफ्राइटिस. The capsule of the kidney, it is thickened and it cannot be easily removed from the renal surface. Kidney would be small in size, irregular surface, and there will be depressed scars which can be haphazardly situated or they can be at times at the poles depending upon the underlying etiology of chronic pyelonephritis. Then coming on to cut surface appearance of kidney. On cut surface, there will be coarse, discrete corticomedullary scars, and these scars will overlie calluses which are dilated. These are blunted, deformed, and papillae would be flattened. So these are depicted in these two photographs on the right, and the areas with the cortical scarring as well as the dilated blunted calluses, these are highlighted by these red colored boxes. And as it would make sense that the majority or the marked changes, they will be seen mainly in the upper and lower poles. At times, impacted calculi, they can also be appreciated in pelvic lesion system if it is because of obstruction. So again, in these two pictures, we can see that the pelvic ischial system, it is markedly dilated, the calluses, they are blunted, and the renal parenchyma which is overlying these dilated calluses, it is markedly scarred and is atrophic, that is, it is very much decreased in thickness. Next is microscopic appearance of chronic pyelonephritis. Although the characteristic changes, they will involve predominantly the tubules and interstitium, but later on all the components of kidney, they will be involved, that is glomeruli will also show some degree of changes, and also vessels, they will have some degree of changes. So starting with tubules will show atrophy in some areas and they will be hypertrophied and dilated in other areas. These dilated tubules with flattened epithelium, they may contain these eosinophilic colloid casts which is called as thyroidization. As you can see on this photomicrograph on the right, in the top area of this slide where it is marked by this yellow colored parenthesis, we can see that these multiple dilated tubules like cyst-like structures, which are actually tubules, they are there and they are lined by this flattened out epithelium, which is although not very much appreciable at this magnification, but we can see that there are multiple cystic spaces and they have these eosinophilic secretions in their lumina. So they appear as if these are thyroid follicles. So they resemble thyroid follicles. That is why the term thyroidization of tubules, it is used for tubules in a case with chronic pyelonephritis. Then interstitium will show chronic inflammation as well as fibrosis. And if there is ongoing acute inflammation, then at times neutrophils can also be seen. Then vessels, arcuate and interlobular arteries, they will show obliterative sclerosis and hyaline arteriosclerosis. Glomeruli, they can show variety of changes. They may be normal with periglomerular fibrosis, or they can be ischemic fibrous obliteration in later stages because of large areas of fibrosis and inflammation. As we had discussed earlier also, that in cases with renal ablation where there is loss of large amount of renal parenchyma, so secondary type of FSGS can also develop. So similarly, in a case with chronic pyelonephritis, in a subset of patients, these changes, which is secondary FSGS, this can also be observed. Then finally, calluses. These are dilated and deformed, and they will have pericallusal fibrosis and chronic inflammation. So this is a low power photomicrograph of a case with chronic pyelonephritis. On the top, we can see thyroidization of tubules, where the tubules, they have been converted into these cystic spaces with central eosinophilic colloid casts. And at the bottom, we have this dilated deformed calyx, which is marked by this black colored asterisk. This is a hypar picture of a case with chronic pyelonephritis. This picture I have taken from this website, ilovepathology.com. This shows all the features of chronic pyelonephritis. We can see in the center, we have these cystic spaces, which have these eosinophilic colloid casts. So these are thyroidization of tubules. Then we can see some preserved glomeruli, two at the right upper corner and one on the left. And then we have these hyalinized sclerotic multiple masses are there, which are sclerosed glomeruli. And we can also see that in between these sclerosed masses, there is this mononuclear inflammatory infiltrate is there, and along with some degree of fibrosis. This photomicrograph again shows a glomerulus in the center, which is almost preserved, but it has a periglomerular fibrosis. Similarly, on the right side, we have glomerulus, which has undergone complete sclerosis. Similarly, in the interstitium, we have these mononuclear chronic inflammatory cells. This photomicrograph again of chronic pyelonephritis beautifully depicts the thyroidization of tubules. You can see these multiple cystic spaces which have flattened epithelium. It's hardly appreciable. And in the center of these tubules, we have these eosinophilic colloid secretions, hence giving the name thyroidization of tubules. Also, we can appreciate chronic inflammation in the interstitium. This is a line diagram of chronic pyelonephritis. Here we can see that the glomeruli, some of them are preserved and show periglomerular fibrosis. Others have become completely sclerosed, like the one on the left upper corner. The tubules, they show these eosinophilic colloid casts, and the lining epithelium of tubules is flattened out. Thus, the change which is called as thyroidization of tubules. In the interstitium, we have fibrosis, which is depicted by these pink colored fibers, as well as there is chronic inflammatory infiltrate in the interstitium, depicted by these blue blobs. And also on the right upper corner, we have a vessel which is showing hyalinization. So all the components of kidney, they are affected in chronic pyelonephritis, starting with tubules, interstitium, glomeruli, calluses, as well as the vessels. Then just a word about a special type of chronic pyelonephritis, which is called as xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis. This is associated mainly with protease infection and obstruction. So grossly, these areas with xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis, they appear yellowish orangish, and microscopically these areas correspond to collections of foam cells and foreign body giant cells. This is yet another example of pyelonephritis, where we had earlier discussed that in some cases pyelonephritis can be because of viruses. This case is a case with the polyoma infection, and these broad black arrows, they depict intranuclear inclusions of polyoma virus. As we had discussed that these type of infections, these are mainly seen in immunocompromised patients. Coming on to next condition, which is somewhat related to what we have discussed, it is called as urinary tract obstruction or obstructive uropathy. Urinary tract obstruction increases susceptibility to infections and stone formation. This we have already discussed. Unrelieved obstruction almost always leads to permanent renal atrophy because of backflow of urine and back pressure, and this leads to hydronephrosis or obstructive uropathy. So what is this hydronephrosis? This is dilatation of renal pelvis and calluses, and it is associated with progressive atrophy of renal parenchyma due to obstruction of urine outflow. Most of the cases are surgically correctable and medically treatable. Therefore, it is pertinent to identify urinary tract obstruction before it causes significant damage. So this is one of the avoidable causes of end-stage renal disease. If this obstruction is identified in time and corrected, then a fair number of renal tissue it can be salvaged. Coming on to etiopathogenesis, obstruction, it can be sudden or insidious, it can be partial or complete, unilateral or bilateral, and it can occur at any level of urinary tract. Starting with the etiology of urinary tract obstruction, first would be congenital anomalies. These can occur anywhere in the urinary tract, starting with posterior urethral valves or urethral strictures, meatal stenosis, phimosis, bladder neck obstruction, pelvic-urethric junction narrowing, and severe vesico-urethral reflux. So there are a variety of congenital anomalies that can lead to urinary tract obstruction and ultimately leading to loss of renal parenchyma. Then there can be presence of urinary calculi, which can originate in calluses or pelvis of the kidney, and then they can, if depending upon their size, they can travel down lower and cause obstruction anywhere in the urinary tract. Then benign prostatic hypertrophy in the case of elderly males. Then various tumors, which can be either of urinary tract origin or they can be external to it. Urinary tumors like carcinoma prostate, bladder tumors, they can also cause obstruction, or they can be external compression or infiltration by tumors which are in close association with urinary tract, like retroperitoneal lymphomas, carcinoma cervix or uterus. Then various kinds of inflammation like prostatitis, ureteritis, urethritis and retroperitoneal fibrosis all can cause potential obstruction. Then at times sloughed papillae or blood clots which are generated in the kidney, they pass down lower down and in the ureter, they can cause blockage and obstruction. Then pregnancy, then uterine prolapse and cystocele, and finally there can be functional disorders like neurogenic bladder in the case of spinal cord damage and diabetic nephropathy. So these different causes of urinary tract obstruction, these can be divided into congenital causes or acquired causes. They can originate anywhere in the urinary tract. In congenital causes, we have various anomalies, and in acquired causes, we can have benign causes also and malignant causes as well. Similarly, the causes, they can be internal to the urinary tract as well as external to urinary tract. Next is pathogenesis, how obstruction anywhere in urinary tract leads to obstructive uropathy. So obstruction anywhere in the urinary tract would interfere with free outflow of urine, and this would lead to accumulation of urine in the urinary tract. So there will be dilatation of pelvis and calluses. Over time, accumulation of urine will lead to back pressure, which will lead to pressure atrophy of renal parenchyma. So functionally, tubular function is lost first, and this is followed by loss of GFR. And because of obstruction, there will be interstitial inflammation and fibrosis. And because of back pressure, ultimately the kidney will be converted into a big bag of sterile or usually infected urine with just a rim of renal tissue left at the periphery. So this is the pathogenesis of obstructive uropathy. Now these two terms are sometimes used to describe obstructive uropathy or hydronephrosis. These are extrarenal hydronephrosis and intrarenal hydronephrosis. So extrarenal hydronephrosis develops early in the course of the disease. Here only the renal pelvis and calluses, they are dilated to an extent, but predominantly the renal pelvis is dilated and renal parenchyma is relatively preserved. Later on, as the obstruction, if it is not relieved, it goes on dilating, and ultimately the calluses, they are also dilated, and because of back pressure, renal parenchymal atrophy also starts appearing, and this fluid, or which can be either sterile or infected, it starts accumulating in the kidney, ultimately converting the kidney into a big bag which is has a just rim of renal parenchyma at the periphery. Coming on to morphology, grossly, depending upon the level of obstruction, bladder, ureter, kidney, any of these may be affected. If we talk about kidney, then it will be slightly to massively enlarged. The calluses and pelvis, they are dilated with blunting of apices of pyramids, which ultimately follows in cupping. Dilated calluses, these are converted into cystic spaces in advanced stages, which communicate with the pelvis. This is different from polycystic kidney disease, where these multiple cysts, they do not communicate with the pelvis. There will be renal parenchymal atrophy of varying degrees depending upon the duration of obstruction. Cause of obstruction can be observed at times in situ. For example, in this picture on the right, the second picture, it has a stone in the pelvis which is impacted here, and we can see that there is considerable loss of renal parenchyma. It is just converted into a multicystic bag with just a rim of renal tissue left at the periphery. Microscopy, there will be interstitial inflammation and fibrosis, and there will be atrophy of tubules and glomeruli. So these two gross pictures, these are both are of obstructive uropathy. The one on the left side, we can see that there is dilatation of pelvis and calluses, there is blunting of calluses, and these are almost converted into a cyst-like spaces, and there is some degree of renal tissue is still left, whereas in the specimen on the right side, the renal tissue, it is almost completely lost and it is converted into a sac which is multiloculated, and just a rim of renal tissue is left. And we can also identify an impacted stone in the pelvis region of this kidney. Then clinical features. Chronic pyelonephritis may be insidious in onset, or it can present with recurrent attacks of acute pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis associated with reflux, it can have a silent course and present late in the course of disease with hypertension and renal insufficiency. Obstructive uropathy, it can be silent in unilateral involvement. However, bilateral partial involvement presents with inability to concentrate urine, presenting with polyuria and nocturia, as we had discussed earlier also, that tubular features will be the first one to present. Some features will develop secondary renal calculi, salt wasting, and hypertension. Complete bilateral obstruction will result in oliguria or anuria, which is incompatible with survival unless the obstruction is removed. So there can be variable clinical presentation in these patients, or at times the onset can be completely insidious and it can present late in the course of disease, where a lot of or considerable amount of renal tissue is lost and the patient will present with hypertension and renal insufficiency. Starting with the next entity, which is urolithiasis, also known as renal calculi and kidney stones. So urolithiasis is a common clinical problem and it affects around 4-15% of Indian population. Men are more frequently affected than females, with a peak age around 20-30 years. Calculi, they can form anywhere in urinary tract, although kidney is the most common site of formation. Coming on to pathogenesis, there can be many causes for initiation and propagation, but the two most important factors are supersaturation and low urinary volume. So what is this supersaturation? There increased urinary concentration of stones constituents is there, which exceeds solubility. So because of that, they get precipitated or supersaturation. Second is, otherwise the patient is metabolically normal, but there is presence of low urinary volume in a patient, and that also predisposes to development of these stones. So the common types of renal stones are calcium oxalate or calcium phosphate, or mixed calcium oxalate calcium phosphate stones. Then magnesium ammonium phosphate, which are also called as struvite or staghorn stones. Then uric acid stones, cysteine stones, and other stones. Most of these stones they form within the renal calyces and pelvis. If they are formed in pelvis, they tend to remain small, around 2 to 3 millimeter. These can be single or multiple, and they can have smooth or irregular surface. Also, they can take shape of renal pelvis and calyces. Accretion of salts may lead to branching structures known as staghorn calculi, which take the shape of pelvic ileal system. Now let's briefly discuss the various salient features of urinary stones. The most common ones amongst these are calcium stones, which can be calcium oxalate, calcium phosphate, or mixed stones. These account for about 75% of the total stones. They tend to occur in patients with hypercalciuria, which can be with hypercalcemia or without hypercalcemia. Now these types of stones, they tend to precipitate in alkaline medium, and the factors which contribute towards precipitation or formation of these types of stones is because of supersaturation of these calcium ions in urine. Also, low urinary volume, oxaluria, and hyperuricosuria all contribute towards development of calcium phosphate or calcium oxalate stones. Then next common variety of stones are struvite stones, also called as magnesium ammonium phosphate stones. These account for about 15% of the cases, and these tend to occur in patients with urinary infections with urea splitting organisms like Proteus. So what do these organisms do? They split urea into ammonia, which gives rise to alkaline pH of urine, and this is done with the help of urease enzymes. And because of that, these alkaline medium, these various salts like magnesium, ammonium, phosphate, they all precipitate, leading to formation of struvite stones. These struvite stones, they have special appearance, like they have staghorn appearance, where they have multiple projections on their surface, and they tend to be quite large in size, and they tend to fill the pelvis and calyces. Then next is uric acid stones. These are about 6% of the total, and they occur in patients with hyperuricosuria with or without hyperuricemia, which can be primary or secondary. These types of stones, they tend to form in acidic urine, and this is because this uric acid, it has lower solubility in acidic medium. Then less common ones are cystine stones, which tend to happen in patients with genetic defects of cystine transport. And then we can have other types of stones which are less than 2% of the total, where there are other abnormalities of amino acid metabolisms. So coming on to the gross appearance of these stones, calcium oxalate stones, they have smooth whitish appearance. Then uric acid stones, they have gray, yellowish, whitish appearance, and on cut surface they have concentric laminations. Cystine stones, they are shiny, smooth, multiple whitish stones, and struvite stones, they have multiple projections on their surface, giving the name staghorn stones because they tend to take on the shape of calyces and pelvis. Just a special point about uric acid stones, that these are radiolucent stones as compared to calcium oxalate stones, which are radioopaque. Coming on to clinical features, these stones, they can present with either features of obstruction or due to ulceration of lining epithelium and bleeding. Many will remain silent and or present with dull pain if they are in the kidney, or colicky pain if they pass on into the ureters. In general, small stones, they are more hazardous because they can pass into the ureters and cause ureteric colic, which is the most painful colicky pain. Then larger stones, they can stay at the site of formation and present with hematuria and infection because of causing stasis at the site of their impaction. There are different investigations that can be done for renal calculi. Urine microscopy can be done, where we can identify pus cells, RBCs, casts, and at times urinary crystals also. Then renal function tests, CBC, can show neutrophilia. Then we can do X-ray KUB, intravenous pyelography, renal ultrasonography can be done, and non-contrast computed tomography. All these radiological investigations along with urine microscopy, RFTs and CBC, these are helpful in evaluation of patients with renal calculi. So this was all about tubulointerstitial diseases of kidney. In the next lecture, which also happens to be the last lecture of this series, we will talk about renovascular diseases and renal tumors.